Hey, everybody. I want to take a second and I want to talk about something that I know is controversial. All right. And it's not the most organized and easy topic to kind of talk about. So just bear with me. The topic is whether or not, in fact, it is important or necessary to know what it is that an elk is actually saying when it's vocalizing, all right? Do you really need to know what a cow is saying when she gives a certain call, whether when she gives a lost mew or when she gives a mew or whatever? Is it important to know that? Now, obviously, I think it's important. I built an entire website around that fact, all right? However, I know that there are some and some very successful elk hunters that do not believe that to be the case. They do not believe that it's important to know what you're saying. Rather, they feel it's more important to have high quality sounds, you know, that you can make high quality cow sounds or high quality bugles, all right? That you use quality calls and that you put a lot of feeling or emotion into your calling. Well, I agree with both of those things. I do. But for me, I would argue, how can you put emotion into something if you don't know what you are saying? How do you add emotion to your calling if you don't know what you're saying with your calling? All right? Now, again, I know there are folks that are very, very successful who don't necessarily understand maybe what elk are saying. And I know that even some of what I talk about is controversial because there are other people out there talking about, well, this is what an elk says and this is what an elk does, et cetera, et cetera. And I will tell you that a lot of those other people I disagree with. I disagree with wholeheartedly because their conclusions, their interpretations, and what they are saying, in my opinion, is not based in sound behavioral sciences, observational science, whatever. It's not based in sound science, in my opinion. And if you look at the bulk of people that are out there talking about elk behavior, elk vocalizations, elk ecology, whatever, most of, and calling and hunting and strategies, most of them focus on the time period around September, maybe end of August through September, beginning of October. They're focusing on the time period around the rut. Okay, well, that's fine. That's important. That's good. But if all we do is look at what happens during the rut, when bulls are heavily influenced by testosterone, testosterone throws a wild card into anything. And into everything, really. And the same, I think, can be said about cows with their estrus cycle, all right? If we think about it, there are times that we go into the field and we walk up the side of the mountain and we hear a bull bugle and if we don't know what we're saying, we just go out there and we throw out a whole bunch of cow sounds. We just start rattling off a whole bunch of cow sounds. Meow, 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 meow. And you sound, how many times have we heard this? Like a bunch of elk. All right, and the bull bugles. Sometimes the bull bugles, and he cannot get to us fast enough. He about runs us over trying to get to us because he heard our calling and he wants to be in there. Great. By the same token, however, how many times have we gone up there and we've done the exact same thing, we've vocalized the exact same way, but that bull just turns around and gone? Or shuts up and doesn't respond, or just doesn't come in, or we never even find the bull to begin with. What gives? We did the same thing. We're dealing with an elk. What gives? Well, a couple of things. Number one, there are all sorts of different elk on the landscape. There, you know, you'll hear me talk about it in some of the later videos. There's some elk that are, you know, bulls especially. There are some that are lovers, and there's some that are fighters. And there's a whole range of bulls in between. Some just want to be left alone. Some are stupidly aggressive. And that's just their nature. So we never know which type of elk that we're running into. Number one. Number two, when testosterone gets in, thrown into the mix, we all know that it can make animals stupid. Bulls, or whether we're talking about whitetails, whether we're talking about mule deer, bucks, whether we're talking about elk, you throw the rut into things and it throws that wild card in, and they can be wildly unpredictable. And sometimes, yes, they do come smoking in and about run us over. I explain that and talk to you about that in the behavior series, all right? Well, sometimes, yes, we are going to encounter a bull that is going to be so eager to run us over that it doesn't matter what we say, all right? But if all we do is we focus on what's happening in September, then it's hard to tease out any sort of concrete interpretation because there's so many stinking variables that are just thrown in the mix. You've got the different behaviors of the bulls. You have the testosterone cycling. You've got pressure from other hunters. You've got the environmental factors. You've got the cows themselves and their hormone. You've got the social structure of the cows and how they're interacting with the bulls. You have the sex ratio of the bulls to cows. You have the interspecific competition between bulls with other bulls. And then you have the age structure of the bulls that are out there dealing with. You've got all those variables that are all in play in September. So when I sit there and I go, mew, and a bull runs me over on this ridge, but then I walk over to that ridge and I go, and the bull's standing right there. He's looking at, he's messing with his cows. I can see him. I go to call him, mew, and he turns and walks away. What in the world is the difference? I did the same thing. I vocalized the same way. Why is there a difference? Well, obviously, there's a behavioral difference in there, but by the same token, what I said may or may not speak to what's going on with that particular the bull at that time in that situation. This is where I started to develop my opinions, and where I saw it matters what you are saying, how you're saying it, and for understanding why you're saying it, all right? The other thing, and you can take a look in the about section under me and my background, but when you start, like I said, when you look at everything in September and you realize, my gosh, there's so many variables, there's so many wild cards, that how do you make sense of it all? Well, you do what I did and what I continue to do. Skip it. Take a step back and you get yourself away from September. Get yourself away from October. And then start going back out there in November, in December, January, February. Go out there in May, in June. Go out there July and August. Start taking a look at what elk are doing, what they're saying, how they're communicating, the words that they are using. If we want to put it in human context, the words that they're using. What are they doing in December? What are they doing on their winter range? How are they communicating with one another? And what are they saying? And what are the interactions? What are the results? If a cow vocalizes one way, what was her body language? Who was she vocalizing to? What was the reaction of that other animal? And then did that animal vocalize back, or did that animal do something specific? Then go out in the spring when they get ready for calving and follow them into their calving area. And start watching them interact with one another and their calves especially. What are they saying? When are they saying it? What is the outcome of that interaction? And when you start to take a bigger look and you step back and you go, wait a minute. She said this in May and that calf did this. She did X, the calf did Y. Okay. Well, in July on the summer range, I heard another cow say X, and wait a minute, that calf did Y. In late November and December, we were on the winter range, and I heard a cow do X, and another cow did Y. They're all the same. Didn't matter what time of year they were, this vocalization was given, this reaction was received, or this response was received. All right? Well, if it happens in April, May, June, if it happens in July, if it happens in November, December, Why wouldn't it happen in September? All right, go test it. And that's what I did. I'd go out during hunting season, and I would test it. I'd go, and I would send out the vocalization, and I would get the reaction I saw in June. I would get the reaction I saw in July, and I would get the reaction I saw in December. And the more time I spent watching and listening and learning what elk are saying, the more times I started seeing those correlations between different vocalizations. Now, I do get into, in a later video, especially the bull vocalizations and communication video series under the glunk. Don't skip to that video. Just understand we'll talk about that in this video. If you get in the glunk, we talk about correlation versus causation, all right? And I get into all that. However, from an observational research and behavioral observation standpoint, these things were consistent. And then when I go and I test them in September and October and even late season November, I can do the exact, I can elicit the same response, or I can elicit the same reaction from elk that elk are eliciting from other elk when they do it. That's what was my light bulb in my head and saying, wait a minute, no. Yes, it does matter, because now if I know what they're doing and saying in June, July, and August, and it is consistent with what happens in November, December, January, then when I go out here in in September, and I'm dealing with testosterone, I'm dealing with estrogen, I'm dealing with hunting pressure, I'm dealing with all of these other variables that I cannot control that are not consistent, I can fall back and rely on those things that are consistent. And they are the fundamental building blocks of the vocalizations that I talk about and what they mean, why they are used, what an elk expects when they hear it, and then how we can use it, and more importantly, why do we use it at certain times, all right? If, and I give, and it, let me take another step, or take it another step further. When I'm doing my seminars, there's an example that I always give, and I think it helps folks understand it a little bit better. Now, I understand that elk are not people, all right? And there's a lot of people that try to make animals into humans, all right? Walt Disney and Animal Planet always try to make animals seem like they're people, and ooh, how cute and cuddly and precious they are. Sure, they are. However, there can be some pitfalls when we start putting human attributes to animals. But when we're looking at behavior, especially when we're dealing with behavior of very highly social social animals, a social species like elk, that has a very diverse vocabulary like elk, there are a lot of parallels and correlations with what they do and with what we do. And so you'll hear me throughout the elk module talk about what elk are doing and what elk are saying in a context of how we would say it or what we are doing, all right? I do use our examples to draw parallels with what elk are doing and vice versa, all right? It just helps make things a little bit easier to understand. And one example I always give in the seminars to kind of explain this concept is the fact that think about how we are, all right? Now, with elk, we're talking about the two different types of philosophies: knowing what you're saying, and saying things with a purpose, and saying things strategically, and very with a, no pun intended, with some of the stuff I talk about here, a very targeted purpose and reasoning. Versus, it doesn't matter what you say; you don't have to understand it. You just need to sound good. So you just put elk calls out there. All right, you got those two kind of schools of thought. Well, if we put it in the same context with us, all right, imagine this. Say you're at the grocery store. You have a list of groceries that you need to get, right? On your list of groceries is, say, I don't know, broccoli, carrots, doesn't matter. You've got a vegetable down in the produce department, right? So you're pushing your little cart, you're grabbing your toothpaste and your toilet paper or whatever, and you push your cart, and you come around the corner, and you look down and you can see the produce department right there. Next one on your list is carrots. Okay, broccoli, whatever. You can see it. It's right there. You're heading that way. And all of a sudden, someone walks in, puts a little crate down, gets up on the crate and says, pencil, automobile. Bootlace, toothbrushes. Automobile, bootlace, steering wheel, winter jacket. Now, how many of you would go talk to that guy? All right, think about it, right? I mean, just how many of you watching this right now would go up and be like, man, I want to go talk with that guy? All right, now I know from all the other seminars, I know exactly what the reaction is. The vast majority of you are going to be like, no, I'm not going to go talk to him. No. Now, that's the vast majority. However, there are a couple of you that be like, I'd go up and at least try to figure out what he's doing. Okay? So there's a few of you that would kind of go over there and try to figure out what the issue was or what the situation was. And then there are still some that'd be like, oh my gosh, that would be funny. I would just go up and just mess with him. And so they would go up and engage him. All right? But again, if you're like most of us, you see some guy jump up on a crate in the produce department of a grocery store and start yelling pencils and automobiles and bootlaces and, well, he said toothbrush and I got a toothbrush, but then all of a sudden winter jacket, what? All right? What is wrong with that? All those words are words in the, I know what a toothbrush is, I know what a pencil is, I know what an automobile is, steering wheel, bootlace, I know what all these things are. They're words in the English language. Okay, so what's wrong? What's wrong with that guy just making a whole bunch of words, just sending a whole bunch of words out there? Most of us get it. Most of us say, well, it doesn't make sense. It's kind of weird. It doesn't make sense. Why? Because what does a pencil have to do with an automobile, have to do with a bootlace, have to do with a toothbrush or a winter jacket? And what in the world does any of that have to do with the produce department of a grocery store? Not only do the words not fit with one another, they don't even fit within the context that we're standing in, all right? Okay, now let's flip it around. Flip around the other way. We're grabbing our toothbrush and our toilet paper. We push our cart around the corner. We look down. We're on our way to get our carrots. We look down to the produce department. All of a sudden, someone puts a little crate down, stands up on the crate and says, ladies and gentlemen, for the next hour, Colorado peaches are a penny a piece, no limit. Okay. Or Georgia peaches or whatever you want, or Washington apples, whatever, wherever you are, whatever that delicacy, that seasonal ooh-ah thing is, for the next hour, penny a piece, no limit. Now how many people would go down and talk to that guy? All right? Much different. Almost every single person that I've ever done this to in a seminar would be like, oh yeah, absolutely. Now, some of you would say, I don't want to jump to that yet. Obviously, the reason why we feel much more comfortable with that scenario is the fact that, okay, every word that he used made sense. What he was talking about. You had the noun, the verb, the pronouns. You had sentence structure, all right? Not only was he using words in the English language, those words related to one another in a logical, progression, and they actually made sense in the context of a grocery store, all right? So it really doesn't matter what he was saying. It all just made sense. So, of course we're going to go want to talk with the guy. Now, the easy parallel, again, in this situation, I could just say, okay, well, that's it. Obviously, if we go out there and we call and we just throw a whole bunch of cow sounds out there and we end up sounding like the first guy talking about pencils and automobiles, well, okay, it sounds weird that words don't, the cow vocalizations that we use don't go with one another and they don't fit within the context. They might not fit within the context that we're sitting in. So, okay, elk might not want to come in. Whereas the other way, if we understand what an elk is saying and we use the vocalization strategically in the right order, in the right context, well then, okay, an elk is going to want to come in because, it makes sense and he likes what we're saying. Absolutely. That's the top layer right there. Bam. But here's the key. Here's why I think it's even more important. Again, go back and watch the previous video of what my core fundamental influence was. What if you don't like peaches? What if you don't like what that guy was selling? What if you don't want what he's selling? Let's go back to the first example. You have carrots on your list or broccoli. When you went around the corner and you looked and it was right there and he walked up and set it in front of the display. In order for you to get your carrots or your broccoli, you have to go up there and get close to him. You have to get in close proximity to the guy that's yelling pencils and automobiles and bootlaces. How many of you would still go get your carrots? How many of you would still go up there and get close to that guy? Now, let's take about the peaches or whatever, you know, apples or whatever you want to say. What if you don't like peaches? What if you don't like apples? How many of you would go get your carrots or your broccoli? In that first situation, yes, we felt weirded out. We felt something was wrong with that first guy in that first situation. So we did not want to go and engage him. But most of us that are watching this now are probably in the same boat that everybody else in my seminars were in the fact that we go, wait a minute, not only do I not want to engage him, I don't really know if I really want to go get my carrots right now. I don't even know if I want to be near him. And so a lot of people will say, nope, scratching that off the list. I'll just wait till he leaves. Or I'll come back and I'll get it some other time. I really don't need to get carrots right now. No, I'm just going to avoid it. Because the whole situation that they heard and saw doesn't make them feel right. And so they're going to avoid not only him, but the area. Whereas the guy that's selling peaches or apples or whatever, even if we do not want what he is selling, we don't think about it. I know what a peach is. I know what an apple is. I know what penny a piece means. And I know what an hour timeline is. That's fine. None of that. I don't care about that. I have no value for that. But everything made sense. Nothing sets me off. I don't think anything is out of the ordinary. And I go about my business and I walk up. I grab my carrots. I do not change my behavior. I do not avoid the area. I just go about doing what I'm doing like nothing ever happened. And that, for me, is the number one reason why I do think it is vital to understand exactly what it is you're saying, how you're saying it, and why you're saying it. Because when we are in the field and we are calling elk, especially if we're in places that it's public ground, heavily hunted, over-the-counter units, where we have to compete with other hunters, and we have limited time, and we are hunting solo, by ourselves, we have to get that animal in front of us. If we are out there and we are yelling pencils and automobiles, yes, there's going to be that freaky bull that wants to come smoking down the ridge and come and stand in our lap. I talk about why that might be in the behavior, the See You First videos, okay? Yes, in some cases, it's in the best interest of an elk to come running in there to make visual eye contact, sure. But they, especially when you're talking about mature bulls, however, you are going to be in a situation where you start throwing pencils and automobiles and bootlaces and winter jackets out there in the field, the elk are going to go, what are they saying? I don't think so. Not only do they not like what you're selling, but now if you're calling next to that meadow that was their feeding area, or you're calling next to that bedding area that was their bedroom, you're calling along that main corridor, or that ridge, or that saddle where they normally walk, if you're calling from there, not only do they not like what you're selling and they don't want to come and engage you, now they very well may change their behavior and avoid that area. If it took you 2 days or 3 days to even just locate an elk, you go in and you do that, and the first time you engage those animals, you affect their behavior that evening or the next morning. They might be a half mile, quarter, a mile, mile and a half, whatever. Who knows where they're going to be, because now they've changed their behavior. Whereas, if we know what we're saying and how we're saying it and why we are saying it, we can go in there to that meadow, that bedding area, that saddle, that corridor, whatever, and we can engage them, we can talk to them, we can give them very strategic vocalizations. And even if they don't like what we're selling, they don't think anything about it. They just go about their business. I have literally been in places where we call, the elk pick their head up, they look, and they just go back to feeding. They've ignored us. That's fine. That's great. I don't care. But they did not change their behavior. I can back out. I can regroup. I can come back that evening. Try a different tactic. Does this tactic work? No, doesn't. No big deal. I back out. I come back the next morning. I work the same group again because I have not changed their behavior. It gives me an opportunity to work the same group of elk or the same bull multiple times to figure out exactly what he wants to come in and finally respond to my calling. Now, I know there are some other people that say, well, fine, if that bull doesn't want to respond, go find another one. Great. If you're in an area that has a ton of elk in it, if you have a ton of elk that you can just go and find, oh, there's another one, there's another one, there's another one. Awesome. Do that. Run and gun, find a bull or find an elk or a group of elk that want to play your game, all right? Find them, go for it. But if you're in one of those areas, and I've hunted them, where you get in a valley and it takes you 3 days, there's elk sign around, they're here somewhere, but you just have to find them. And it took me 3 days to find them, and I realized, wait a minute, there's one group. There's one bull, his group of cows, and that's it. Well, goodness gracious. Now, I know that you know, fitness now and you know, being the hunter athlete is popular now, but how many mountains do I have to, you know, he might be it. So I need to capitalize on him. And especially if I'm a student or somebody who's working and I have to hunt a Saturday and a Sunday morning, I don't have time to go find another bull. I got in this valley, I got in this ridge, bam, there he is. Can I capitalize on it? If I'm just throwing random vocalizations out there, it doesn't matter if I have high quality vocalizations. It doesn't matter if I put a lot of feeling in my vocalizations. If that bull does not like what I'm selling, then I'm not going to be successful. And if I really am not doing, you know, if I'm really just throwing stuff out there and hoping to see what sticks and hoping to get lucky, I very well may end up changing or altering that bull's behavior or that group of cows' behavior. Because again, and I talk about this later on, about call-shy cows versus call-shy bulls and which one really is the more influential party in that matter. If I change that group's behavior, I may be done. When I finally started realizing that, yes, there were specific words and there were specific reactions, and I started making a concerted effort to say, no, I'm going to understand that, and then I'm going to use it. I'm going to use it the way they use it. Not only did my success go way up as far as filling my tags, but more importantly, I wasn't calling in other hunters, and I wasn't getting those elk, they weren't getting all fired up. They weren't screaming their heads off. They weren't going. I didn't have to get them drummed up and excited into a frenzy to where they finally did get stupid and trip up and want to come running in. I could literally move in, slip in, work those elk, and literally kill bulls that all they did was give me a single mew. And here they turn and walk, and here they come. Thwack, done. I just killed my elk, and there's not a single other person in this valley that knows that the elk were even around. For me, yes. Obviously, I built the entire website around the fact that I think it's important to understand what elk are saying. It's up to you to find out whether or not you believe that, you value it, or not. If you do, great. I think you're going to get a heck of a lot out of the elk module. If you don't, if you just want a couple, you're still going to get stuff out of the elk module. But just understand that is why I talk about things the way I talk about them in the elk module, because I want you to be able to capitalize on every single bull, every single elk group that you run into. If we are sitting there looking at a valley, we're sitting at looking at this huge basin, or maybe it's wherever you're hunting, it's a long ridge, and we say there are 10 elk in this valley. We may not know that at the time, but there are in fact 10 different bulls with their cows. There are 10 different groups of elk in here. The elk module, if you understand what you're saying, how you're saying it, and why you're saying it, you will have the tools in your toolbox to go into that valley and engage every single one of those elk, all 10 of them, however they want to be engaged. And that's the key. If we're just throwing sounds out there, hoping to get lucky, then again, what we're hoping to do is find a bull that want, or an elk that wants to play our game. This is our strategy. This is our game. I'm going to throw it out there. Who's with me? And we're hoping that somebody up there sounds off, bugles, and says, yeah, I'm here. I want to come check you out. We're hoping to get lucky. And for those of you that are new, that are just getting started, or that have struggled in the past, you know that when you're throwing stuff out there, you're calling and you're not getting a response day in and day out, your confidence level takes a nosedive. And it's much more difficult for you to stay in one place and really work it and hunt it. It's much more difficult for you to get motivated to get out of the sleeping bag in the morning and make a good morning hunt. It's difficult for you to convince yourself that I do need to stay out until dark and walk back to camp in the dark. And it's even more difficult to say once I've left camp to come back later on the last weekend of season and go, well, let's give it a try. Confidence level starts tanking when you're not confident in what you're confident in what you're doing and you're not getting a favorable response. Just randomly throwing stuff out there, you are hoping, praying that you have one of these 10 bulls in this hypothetical situation that is willing to play your game. There are some people that will absolutely run that whole valley until they find him. I am the person that says, I will start here and I will work every single one of them babies until I find the one I want to take, or the one that gives me the best shot opportunity. And if this bull wants bull vocalizations, great, I can give it to him. If this bull wants cow calls, great, I can give it to him. Oh, this bull has cows and I need to be very specific about how I do my cow vocalizations, that's fine, not a problem, I can do that. Oh, this bull just got ran out and he's very nervous about other bulls and he doesn't want to deal with it, that's fine, I know how to deal with him. I can go across that landscape now and I open up the door of opportunity to work 10 bulls, whereas the other way I only really had an opportunity to work one if I found them. All right, so there it is. That's my philosophy. That's why I think this stuff is important. That is why it has worked well for me. That is why it has worked well for other people that have learned this stuff and have put it in practice. I hope it does the exact same for you. I know that it will do the same for you. So I'm not trying to criticize anybody else's techniques or tactics or what they believe or how they believe it. There are a lot of different ways. They say, you know, a bunch of different ways to skin a cat. Well, absolutely. There's a bunch of different ways to call elk. This is mine. This is how I do it. This is why I do it. And I hope it works for you.